Welcome back to the world of rugs and the world of glitches. Now, this is the second of a two-part series, and I would recommend that you look at the first one first, because in the first one, called The Rug Glitch, fully explained, link in the description, I explored the difference between this rug glitch, where you pick up an object and put it on top of a rug and just kind of carry it around, and that one is really useful because it means you can take large objects like this, pick them up on the end of a rug, and cut them literally into other objects and surfaces as if they aren't even there. And the difference between that glitch and group selecting items, which is when you put items closely together, hold down the select button, and they all turn into whichever color your HUD is. In my case, it's going to be yellow, but in yours, it's probably green. And then you kind of move them around and you can do different things with them. And it is this second glitch, the group select trick, which is perhaps the most misunderstood and the most underutilized, because it is incredibly powerful, for you, especially if you console players that don't have access to things like Place Anywhere mods. You can do awesome things with it. And in this video, I'm going to show you loads of examples. I'm going to show you some brilliant photos from some wonderful creators around the web. And by the time you get to the end of this video, you will fully understand the power of group select. So ask yourself this, my friends. Can we build it? Can we glitch it? Can we group select it? Yes, we can. Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Build It, the group select trick explored. This is such a powerful little tool, and we're going to have a lot of fun today. This trick is all about holding down the select button and selecting objects in a glitch. Now, some YouTubers have called this the concrete pillar glitch, or the foundation trick, but I'm going to be calling it the group select trick. But it's the same principle. And the reason why I'm calling it the group select trick is because it has nothing to do with concrete pillars and nothing to do with rugs. It's to do with group selecting. So I am going to delete this rug right now to show that this has nothing to do with the properties of a rug. It has the properties of group select. Now, it is useful because some objects have a snap. You know, that you get it close to a certain position and it snaps into position. And I showed this little trick in part one. If you want to put an object kind of just offline or very close to the snapping point, you can't, because it will just snap into position and then you are screwed. But if you group select some items together, and you have to sometimes be quite close to get this to work, when you group select these items together, you will then find that this snapping disappears. And you can place the object at angles that you weren't able to before, which is great. Now, it does slightly improve the clipping as well. Now, by the clipping, that's when an object will kind of pass through another object. So I can kind of tuck them just a little bit through there like this. But unlike the rug select, I can't just put it all the way through like that. That's not going to work for us. But it does allow me a lot more freedom about the position that I place these objects. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit later about the power of this particular tool, but I want to clarify a few other things here. Now, the group select trick works with all items in the game. The rug glitch, which we looked at in our previous video and I showed you at the beginning there, works with placeable objects, so candles and the bureau in front of us, the Coke machines and things like that. But any object which is kind of structural, walls, floors, roofs, they won't work with the rug glitch. And that's where the group select trick comes in, because the group select trick basically works with everything. It works with the placeable objects and it works with the structural objects. If you know of any objects it doesn't work with, then do let me know in the description and tell me. But as far as I'm concerned, it more or less works with everything. Now, let's add a little extra power to what we're doing here, because I've just shown you that it removes the clipping. But if we add an object that has the ability to go through floors or to be raised up, it then transmits that property to the other items as well. So I've just grabbed a concrete foundation piece here. I'm going to place it near this wall, group select them, and you can see now the property of the concrete foundation, the ability to go down and up through walls, has been transmitted to this object as well. And I can place it floating in the air, woohoo, and I can place it halfway through the floor. And remember, this works with objects that are structural and not structural. So if I just pick up the other object as well, you can see that works with fantastic. And there's loads of uses for that, you know, just for very, very careful placement of items. And of course, there are a lot of objects that cut through the floor. And I've just kind of laid out a few here. We've got all the new, brand new scaffolding stuff. We've got the concrete pillar, which is why often this is known as the concrete pillar trick, and other walls and wooden foundations, etc. Now, another power of the group's electric is that when you remove the rug, the object doesn't fall down, which is one of the downsides of the group's electric. Now, let's say I wanted to put this sleeping bag on top of this bed to make it look like it's kind of a bit more nicely furnished. You can't do it because it won't kind of go up to it. And you can kind of get it there with the rug. So, for example, if I take this rug, I'm using the big rug here just to make this quicker and easier. I can hang this bed off the edge of this kind of structure, which I'm currently kind of coming on. And so you might think, huzzah, you know, I've now managed to get this sleeping bag hanging to the particular height that I want it. But the problem is here is when you remove the rug, the sleeping bag falls straight back down to the floor. And if we were to do the same here, it would again fall through the floor. But if we are to use the group's electric, and I'm gonna use this foundation here to do it, if these people will get out of the way, then it will actually stay. So if I put the foundation pretty near the sleeping bag, group select them, move it into midair, and then just move the foundation away. I don't even have to put it back in the thing, back in the workshop. It will actually stay hanging. So what you can do then is create illusions using these particular objects. Now, if you use this trick a lot, you'll get very used to kind of holding down, on PC is the E key, and I'm not sure what it is on console, but the thing that makes objects move around like this, and you can kind of move them up and down. But you can get very, very used to kind of getting them into position, moving it around, and the objects, the foundation piece itself still has a clipping box. So if I move the foundation itself into bed, it won't work. But as long as the bed isn't touching it itself, I can actually move this in pretty close, get my height completely where I want it, place it, remove it, and ta-da, and I've placed that object there. And that works with not just sleeping bags, but I can put other objects onto the bed, suitcases, drugs boxes, etc., etc. You know, there gives lots and lots of possibilities because the objects will stay, and you don't have to have that awkward thing where you've got like rugs lying on the floor all over the place because you can't remove them because things will fall off. But you saw there that I was trying to get this quite close, and it was a little bit tricky, and that's because the object that you choose to use is actually quite important. Now, the reason why lots of people use the concrete pillar, it's actually named concrete wall in the game, but you know, whatever, is because it's very small, and it means you get lots and lots of visibility. So I can see either side of this pillar, I can see the object I'm picking up, etc., etc., and it goes up and down. But one of the downsides of the pillar is the range of its select is pretty small. If I group select this pillar, it hasn't selected anything either side of it. If I move it next to this wall here and group select, see, I've got it, but I don't have the foundation on the left. But look at this. If I select the foundation, I think I can probably get it from here. If I select the foundation, just move it just a little bit nearer, it will select the rest of the objects. You see that? And it's actually even got the scaffolding over the left-hand side there as well. I'll deselect that. And I'll just prove that this is the case. If I group select the other way back, see, the pillar doesn't take the foundation, but the foundation does take the pillar. So the kind of the invisible group select box around the foundations is bigger. And this can be really, really useful for you because it means that the object can be further away from the object that you are actually trying to place. So if I was to use this pillar to place this sleeping bag, I would have to have the pillar right up against the sleeping bag in order to get it, which is going to make it a lot harder to place, although the object itself is smaller. If I was to use the foundation, like you saw, I was able to have that gap. I was able to have a gap of about this big between the object I'm actually trying to pick up. Now, of course, if you're trying to put an object into a very kind of small space, or you're kind of tucking through something quite small, then of course the pillar may be the one you need to use because it has that kind of smaller physical space. But by and large, for just general movement, foundations or bigger objects are probably better. Now, hurrah! For those of you that have got the new contraptions DLC, the scaffolding kind of does both for us, because if you take an object like this one, it gives you wonderful visibility because you can see completely through it, and it gives us the larger selection box. You see how that's selected there? You can get a bit more into this if you're fascinated by what selects watch what. If you put an object which is 2x1 next to it, on the side where there's the 2, the selection box is bigger, so that will select it there. But if I turn it round to where the selection box is, to where the object is thinner and smaller, then it probably won't. You see that? And that's why the objects you choose and the object that you, the properties you're looking for will change depending on what you are trying to do. But by and large, I think my favorite one is going to be somewhere between this one, this piece of scaffolding, because it's see-through and has a large selection box, and probably the concrete pillar, because of when you're trying to slot it into those really small spaces. So think carefully about which objects you are actually trying to use. And there's another reason why you might want to consider using the foundation pieces or the scaffolding foundation pieces over the pillar, and that's because the pillar itself often glitches. Sometimes you can kind of quite happily pick up the pillar, group select something, but it can be very hard to kind of place it at its full height. You see that? I can't actually go all the way up. And in order for me to go all the way up, then I need to kind of bring up the pillar a lot higher in the first place, select it all the way down the bottom, and then it's a lot less fussy. But did you see how that the properties of that one actually changed while I was doing that? Whereas the foundations don't have that same problem. The foundations will always go up and all the way down. Now, have you seen what's happened here? Everything's gone slightly weird and gone to the floor, and I now can't adjust the height. This will happen to you a lot while you're using the group select trick. Whenever it happens, deselect it, just single select the anchor piece that you want to use, deselect it, and then regroup select the whole lot, and then it will act absolutely fine and move around for you. So just very, very quick, just show you quickly again. So let's say this one was glitched. It's not, but let's say it was. Deselect, reselect, get rid of it, and select again. It's very, very quick, and it will don't, if you try and move it around while it's doing that weird glitch thing, you can get it back right, but it's a real pain, and it's far quicker just to deselect, select, deselect, group select. Now, why else is this glitch useful? And this is where we're getting into the really, really fun stuff. I've already shown you that when you use the group select trick, you can't kind of cut things in like that, but what you can do is like objects that are like each other will often allow you to pass through as long as the objects are lined up with each other. And I'll show you what I mean by that. So obviously here I've got a wall, and I'm going to try and show you that you can actually put these walls through other walls. So they won't go in like that because that's not lined up. But if I was to line them up exactly flat, so I've got a flat wall up against a flat wall, look at that. It does actually go through, and it doesn't matter of the height of the object, it doesn't matter if the object is floating, but as long as they are lined up, flat object against flat object, they will actually go through. And this is really useful because it allows us to basically, if it's yellow or green in your case perhaps, it is more or less flat. So if I was to place that there and then kind of walk around, you'll see that these objects are lined up pretty much perfectly. You know, there's a little bit of freedom, I can go back a little bit, forward a little bit, but the principle is that they are going to be flat. And this allows us to create unusual designs. So if I was to come over here, I'll grab another flat object. So this one is the little fence piece. If I'm going to grab this one here, it doesn't matter which side I put it, but as long as it's within group select range, I can use it to texture walls. So I could grab any of the kind of flat pieces, the fences, the kind of little barricades, the wire fences, and I can kind of clip them through to create interesting textures as if these have kind of been banded together. And you can see the textures changed a lot. As I go forward and back there, you can see different pieces of each fence kind of is visible and not visible. And so you can really experiment to get the kind of look you're looking for, because sometimes you'll want to have a piece cutting in and cutting out, and other times you'll want to have the piece almost kind of stamped on. But you see, you get this kind of idea that this piece of wood's been kind of banged in and jammed through the metal here, you know, it's almost been kind of wrenched in, and it looks it increases that wonderful kind of homemade look and variety, so you don't get kind of the same pieces over and over and over. But it also allows you to create unusual heights of buildings. Now, I'm just going to put on the screen for you a picture by LimmyLom, who has been so useful with me kind of researching these videos, showing how he's created some textures, unusual textures for his walls. But if you come back to me for a second, you can also use this to create unusual heights. So I can take this wall, place it up. I know when it goes yellow that it's going to be in line, and just choose a height, really. You know, how tall do I want this building to be? You know, I can have one that's half, you know, two-thirds again, almost double height. And just kind of choose a height, and then I can choose the kind of texture I want by kind of going in kind of left and right. And when I'm happy, I'll press this in, I'll remove the original group select trick, and I've got an interesting texture, nicely lined up, and I've now got an unusual height. And again, on the screen now is a picture again by LimmyLom of a building that he's made that is just 1.5 high, which again increases the variety that you can come up with, so all your buildings don't look like kind of cookie cutter versions of the same building, just kind of rearranged. And if you come back to me, you'll see that actually you can do this with wall to wall, but you can also do it with floor to floor, because floors obviously clip together very, very, very nicely, which is often very, very handy, but it means all your shapes are going to be very, very regular. But if you were to take two pieces of floor like this, and I'm going to use the pillar here because I want to have a lot of accuracy, get very, very close to it, group select them, again with the disadvantage of the pillar, could be very close, even close, closer than that, and then I can actually go through it. See that? And because it works, because wall to wall, floor to floor, roof to roof, etc., etc. And I can come in at all sorts of unusual angles. Now, a lovely chap called Martin Haddock has written me a nice post explaining this. You sometimes have to have the floor going up a little bit or down a little bit to get the exact angle you want, but it's so close that it basically just looks like the floor's bobbling slightly. But you can create wonderful effects that make these floors kind of cut into one another to create circles, hexagons, pentagons, whatever you want. And you can then kind of come along with your walls and use the same trick. So if I was to put that there, then we can do the same with the wall piece. Remember, if you use the scaffolding or the foundation pieces, you can be further away from the object, and that is very helpful in this particular case. And then we can just kind of angle it in to try and get the wall where we want it as well. Remember, it won't, you're not allowed to cut through other pieces by much, but you can get the angles that you like. And if it starts glitching too much, remember you can just deselect and reselect. And I'll just put on the screen here, you can see Martin Haddock's beautiful object where he, or his beautiful room, which is almost a complete circle, where he's done some beautiful work with both the floor and the walls to create a truly unique structure, which definitely stands out amongst all of the wonderful pieces that people are submitting to the various Reddits and forums and Twitters and things like that. And if you come back to me live, you will see that I have now just about got this into place. And you can see that I can now take the scaffolding away. And we've got two walls which line up and are more or less following the floor. Obviously, the more you fiddle and the more you kind of play, the more you'll be able to get angles you like. But you can see the principle of how it works, and the possibilities are big. It also works with roof to roof. Now, this is a cool one. Now, you see this roof here. Nicely shaped, isn't it? But if you want to get another roof and put it next to it, it snaps in a really, really unusual way. In fact, doesn't really make sense. If you wanted to kind of create a big roof structure, then you can't really. But you can use the group select trick to do this. And I'm just going to show you a little idea that I saw online from a cool guy called Average Kerning. Might be a cool girl, I'm not sure. I'm just going to put a small bit of roof there, and you'll see why in a minute. So you can see here, this roof just won't go on top of there in any way that's actually useful. So bring it over here. Find yourself a foundation piece, whatever. And again, I'm going to use the scaffolding. And I'm going to group select this by like that. And I'm going to raise it up. But sometimes you will need to take it up even higher than the piece will allow you. And the way you do that is you take it up as high as you can, get yourself another foundation piece, scaffolding piece, whatever. Take that down nice and low. Make sure it's far enough away that it's not going to get in the way of placing it. Group select again once you're near enough, and you will take up the whole thing. So see now how the original scaffolding floating and the roof is even higher than it was? And then you have the power to try and line these things up to create all sorts of awesome creations. And what we're doing here is, just like the walls, the roof needs to be lined up with the other roofs in order for it to go yellow. So I'm looking at the edges here, and I'm looking at the kind of the horizontal. You see there, but it will go yellow only in certain locations. But it will go yellow. And again, just keep moving yourself so you can kind of see there. So I'm deliberately going to kind of move myself back so I can see more, and then move the object away from me, and then kind of move it down. And I'm looking to line up all of the roofs, or roofs, and I'm looking to line up the top of the roof so we get that kind of flush roof going up. That probably won't be exact, but it might well be good enough. So let's just move it out of the way. And you see that? We've created a really cool, interesting looking, far bigger roof. And the reason why we put that first piece in first was because it completes the structure going down. And here's the picture again by Average Kerning, and you can see that they've used this kind of trick to create a wonderfully interesting, it doesn't even look like it's a glitch, but a really interesting roof structure that is unique, and you probably won't see anywhere else. Now, one of the disadvantages of the group select trick is that you can't use it actually inside any structures that you have made yourself. Because firstly, if I was to group select this bed, then it would select the whole room. And in some cases, it won't even let you do it because you're kind of physically standing inside it and there's just too much. But if I was to go outside and do the same thing, let's say I just wanted to select this thing with the doghouse, I group select it. But of course, I actually pick up the whole building, including the foundations and everything, and it's a complete pain. So you actually need to kind of find yourself a bit of room to use these group select tricks. And if you're placing lots of objects, you will probably find yourself kind of running in and running out of the room quite a lot to place these individual objects. And it can often be helpful to actually group together lots of objects together outside of a structure and then move the whole thing in. So for example, if I was to take this roof even further and make it even kind of bigger design, it might be good for me to find a big space and make this whole roof on the floor, all the pieces together, and then move it all in together. And the same goes for the bed thing I did over there. Maybe I'm going to put a few objects together. I want to put the bed, whole bed together, and then take the whole bed in using the group select trick to actually place inside the object itself. But the idea that you can't select do this near player made stuff also opens up other possibilities, because it means if you use this trick on Bethesda made stuff or pre-made stuff, we can never select this house, but we can select objects that are next to this house. And thank you to Man of Red Earth, or Man of the Red as I like to call him, who gave me loads of ideas to show off here. And what we're going to be doing here is putting objects to this wall and then group selecting them off. Let me show you the problem. Here are three objects attached to this wall that I've put together. We've got a light, we've got a painting, we've got a shelf. If I was to group select right next to this, predict what's going to happen. Obviously, I need to get very close to the pillar, but if I group select, it selects everything, including the wall. So that's not helpful to get the objects. And if I was to delete the wall, with these style of objects, everything else has just disappeared as well. So, oh no, what do we do? So what we do is we get our shelf or whatever, put it on a Bethesda wall, then we go get our pillar or our foundation or whatever it is, go right as close to it as possible, then we can group select, and note how it doesn't select the wall, it just takes our object. Now, and then when we move our other object away, that object which before would only snap to a wall will quite happily hang in space and do whatever you want. So here's some cool ideas. You could make yourself a staircase using shelves. Here we go, two bits of wall here together, all shoved with little shelves all shoved next to it. Get the angle right, have a little fiddle check it from all angles, and ta-da! We've got ourselves an ascendable staircase made of shelves. Here is a picture by Martin Haddock again, where he has used this ability to create a wonderful curved staircase, which of course isn't even in the game. Here's another little trick you can do. Take a wall shelf, any type, metal, wood, depends what you're trying to make. Put one down, don't move your character, and just move your mouse or your right stick down a little bit, and you can create this kind of block effect. Now, you could use this to make the border of a door. You could use this to create a little kind of bridge at the top of a store. And you can use it to create a little kind of window frame. Now, I'm using the scaffold piece 2x1 because I want to have a big selection window on this side, but I don't want to have a piece that is necessarily too big. And over here, what I've done is I've placed a few walls together, and I've glitched, using the group select trick, I've glitched this piece here down low to create a frame. And what we can do is we can now place this piece kind of over the lip of the structure to create our shelf. Now, of course, you with all these glitches, you have to kind of angle your camera till you can get the angle that you want, but there will always be a way to see it, and sometimes that involves picking a different piece, but that's another advantage of the scaffold structure. So I'm just going to try and get it so it's about halfway in, halfway out, as it would be, and it's done. We've now got a beautiful little window shelf. For it. Or maybe I could just tuck it just a little bit further in, but the effect's really, really, really nice. Even from this side as well, you can see even if it isn't tucked over, it still gets more of a kind of a shelf look. And of course, because it is a shelf, you can place objects on it and have a proper kind of windowsill with flowers and objects and who knows. You can use the same trick with flags and pictures too. So for argument's sake, I'll put it here. You could use this trick to create a really crap flagpole. You could use this trick to put the flag up against a wall, get the group select trick, select it, and then the flag will hang in space. So get like a pillar and just have the hang the flag up. It won't look great, but it will work. But what we can do here is just a really sneaky little thing. And again, thank you to Man of Red Earth for suggesting this one. Is grab it from the back, put it back on the wall. And all of a sudden, you've created yourself something that's got a very different texture and something that you can actually put other objects on. So, for example, if I go into the power section and the lettering, it will now very... This is an excellent display board for lettering that I could put on top of a shop, that I could put to advertise a way in or whatever. But it looks so much nicer having a nice bit of frame. And, of course, there are different size picture frames, and so you can have different size boards to put that on. So in short, and I'm aware this video has now got quite long, there's loads! I've filled my sanctuary full of examples of things that you can do with this. But you can really just blow open the possibilities of structural design using the group select tool. And obviously you can place other objects in places that they would not otherwise want to be. I hope you found this video useful, and I would love to see what other things you've done with the group select trick or what ideas you have, and please do get in touch, either leaving comments in YouTube or you can tweet me on Twitter or things like that. I'd love to see what you come up with. Thank you so much to LimmyLom, Mad of Red Earth, and Martin Haddock for A, the permission to show their pictures, and B, for all their wonderful ideas and generosity with their times as well. If you've enjoyed the video, please like it, subscribe to the channel. I've got other Build It videos, Mod It videos, role plays, and all sorts that hopefully you will enjoy, so you have no excuse to ever watch anyone else ever again. Thank you for spending your time with me today. See you soon.